Okay, so my name is Saddhanandi, and I'm going to be interviewing Sona right now. Oh, more people arriving. It was interesting thinking about interviewing him when I was thinking about him this morning, because I got to know Bhante particularly through interviewing him, through his through the objects of his decade and through his poetry as well. And I'm getting quite a lot of flashbacks to the conversations I had with him when I was interviewing him. We got to be quite cheeky with each other after a while, and then at one point Akasa Jyoti had to interview me about interviewing Bhante, and then the next day she went to see him, and she said, "Guess what I've been doing?" And she described it, and he said, "Well, Akasa Jyoti, just imagine one day somebody will interview you about interviewing Saddhanandi, about interviewing me," like that. And he had a great sense of lineage in this whole process. He also was quite good at, we often rehearsed the questions that I was going to ask him, but he loved it if I just sort of threw him a wild card every now and then. And I'd say to him sometimes, "Okay, Bhante, I'm going to tell you all the questions." He said, "No, don't tell me. Just surprise me sometimes, Saddhanandi," like that. Which I think it drew out the best in him. He could be kind of more spontaneous. Anyway, me and Sona have talked through the questions just to make sure. And I was thinking if Bhante had been alive and I told him this morning I was going to be interviewing Bhante, he would definitely be quite humorous about that, I reckon. He'd be saying, "Well, Saddhanandi, and what are you going to talk about?" And I'd be saying, "We're going to talk about you, Bhante," like this. And then he'd say, "Probably Sona's a good person to talk about me." So I'm going to ask Sona to introduce himself to all of you, just his history in the movement a little bit. And then the interview's about us hearing about his relationship with Bhante, which stretches an awful long time. I don't know how long. I would think
47 years.
47 years. Yeah, that's quite a long time.
I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll just start off with, just tell us.
So I'm going to introduce myself.
Yeah, well, go on, introduce
you
yourself.
You want me to?
Go on, introduce yourself.
So my name's Sona, and I received that name from Bhante in 1974 at my ordination. I first met Bhante in the autumn of 1972, and I went to live in, I was living in Cambridge, London, then Cambridge, and then I moved up to Norfolk at his suggestion, in North Norfolk. A bit later I lived with him at Padmaloka in the late 1970s, and in 1980, I went off to set up a centre in Stockholm in Sweden. And I was there for about seven and a half years. I then came back to Padmaloka and joined the men's ordination team. And I became the chair after a little while. I was there for, I think, about 12, 13 years. And then I moved to Majumaloka in Birmingham, and I was a bit like a yo-yo at that time, because I actually went back to Padmaloka because I didn't like it at Majumaloka, and when I went back to Padmaloka I didn't like it there either, so I went back to Majumaloka. So I stayed at Majumaloka until about 4 or 5 years, and then I went to Birmingham. I went to Manchester after that, and I started working with Vidyamala and set up Breathworks with her and Ratna Guna. And I was in Manchester till 2014. And when this place opened, I kind of knew this is where I wanted to come and live. And fortunately, so did Vidyamala, because we had been in a relationship for a while. And so we bought a house, just as one does, and moved into a small bungalow in Ledbury. And I come here on Sundays for men's chapter meetings, and I've been a public preceptor for 25 years, but I retired this year from that activity. So, that's probably enough.
Yeah. And what does your name mean, Sona?
It's interesting, my name, because what was he called now? the man from America, Samamati, is that right?
Yeah, could be.
Samamati, he's a scholar. He looked up my name.
Saramati.
He looked up my name for me in the Pali Dictionary because I couldn't find it in there. Yeah. And Banti, when he told me, when he gave me the name, he said it meant gold. And Saramati couldn't find the name gold in Pali. So, but I am told it in Hindi it means gold. And the interesting thing was for me when he gave me the name, well, there were a number of monks in the Pali canon called Sona. And when he gave me the name, and he said, I've given, and he's explaining it to everyone as well, that he gave me this name because, I think he said, because I reminded him of gold. And then he kind of enumerated all the qualities of gold. It's precious, it doesn't corrode, it doesn't tarnish, it's pure. It's ductile, it's soft. It's a very beautiful metal. And he said, there's only one problem, and this is the bit I remember very clearly, there's only one problem with gold, and that is you have to dig it out of the ground. And when you've dug it out of the ground, it's covered in dross, and you have to purify the gold. So I think you just left it there, actually. I kind of felt a little bit short-changed, actually, because my name was so short. But over the years, I've come to really appreciate it, because I can use it all the time. So. But that's kind of the sense of humour he has, and he has a little glint in his eye when he says these things, particularly about the dross. Yeah.
Do you remember your first meetings with him?
Well, I remember the very first time I met him. It was in it was on a cold autumn night. Probably wasn't that cold, actually. It was in September 1972. Someone called Jeremy Goody, whose sister is here today. He's now called Loka Mitra, but he had got me going to Hatha Yoga classes the year before or 2 years before. And he said, you need to take up meditation. And I said, well, I'm not really, I'm all right doing yoga, it's all right. He said, no, you must come and meet this guy called Bunty. So I said, oh, all right. And so we went along to the, there was a centre in North London, Tufnell Park, Archway. We went in to this building, and he introduced me to this bloke. I was just trying to pretend I wasn't there, just looking at, how new people are. They look at the books and just pretending. I was very shy. Mm. And anyway, he introduced me to Bunty. I didn't know why he introduced me to Bunty, because, he was like a 40-year-old old man. Because I was so young, I thought he was quite old. Mm. And he said, this is Bunty. And I thought, oh, hello, Bunty, how are you? And just started chatting to him. And then a little while later, I went upstairs to the shrine room, and there was Bunty in his yellow robes and his beard. And did he have a beard? No, he had big mutton chops, sideboards, and long hair. And I thought, he must be some sort of monk or something. So I thought it was really cool, this guy who was wearing these Buddhist robes. Mm. I kind of expected a shaven head, but I thought it was really cool that he was like a hippie, and so that was my, and then I realised his name was Banti, not Bunty. So, and I got to know him, because those of you who know Loka Mitra, he can be a force to be reckoned with. He suggested that since I was one of the few order members that had a job at those days, I wasn't an order member actually, but I was one of the few people going to the centre who had a job, I think. And I had a car, and he thought that as I lived in Golders Green, I could drop Banty off in Muswell Hill, because it was on the way. It wasn't really, but I thought, okay, why not? And he said, you get to know him that way. And I thought, oh, okay. And so I remember driving him and a guy called Mark to Muswell Hill, where he was living. And again, it was just like being with someone quite ordinary. I said, just what you've been up to today. And he would chat to me, and it was all very kind of normal. I kind of thought of him, I think, a bit like my yoga teacher. I'd just been to yoga classes and for 2 years, and I was going to learn meditation. There was this kind of, you know, like yoga teacher type person who was going to teach me to meditate. And so it was quite there was no kind of reverence or anything like that. I respected him as I did my yoga teacher. So it was just very normal, really. Mm. Yeah. Mm. That was a little bit of then kind of the beginning of the kind of relationship I had with him is that I drove him around a lot. And what's nice about driving someone around, particularly on long journeys, you get to spend quite a lot of time with them and chatting and things. So that was the very early days. Mm. And then shortly after that, I moved to... I must have been in the process of moving to Cambridge, and I've forgotten what I was going to say now.
Let me ask you something else. I might come back to you in a minute. I'm just thinking that you think of yourself as Bante's disciple, yeah, but when you're describing driving around from up to Muswell Hill and whatever, you're not thinking like that.
No. So that's a very good question. Glad you asked.
So when did you start thinking that you were actually a disciple?
Before that happened, let me just say something else, is that, Bhante didn't just teach me meditation. He, I'd been going to the Archway Centre for 2 or 3 weeks, learning to meditate, Loka Mitra said, he's giving a talk. Why don't you come along to that? So I went along to one of Bhante's talks. It was on the Tantric Paths series. And I listened to the talk. I had no idea what he was talking about. It seemed way above my head. But something resonated within me. And something spoke to me. And I felt very... very interested, and this was very important, and so I just kind of wanted more of it, really. But how I learned that I was Bhante's disciple went something like this. An order member called Deva Raja suggested that I went to see a lama in Cambridge, because I didn't have any sangha in Cambridge in the early 1970s, and just to have a meeting with, you know, a Buddhist would be nice. So I mentioned this to Loka Mitra. I was thinking of going and seeing this Tibetan Lama. And Loka Mitra said, why don't you check with Bhante? You know, it'd be a good idea. And I was thinking, why? Why would I check with Bhante? You know, it's just, I'm going to go see this Lama. And anyway, I thought Loka Mitra suggested, so I thought, I'll give him a ring. So I phoned up Bhante and I asked him what he thought about it. And he said, it'd be okay, you could do that. But just make it clear to him where your loyalties lie, and they lie with the FWBO, as it was called then. I didn't know that. So that's how I knew that I was his disciple, he told me. And it was quite a relief, really, because I realised he was right. I mean, it wasn't, I'm not someone just to follow someone because they say so, but it was a bit like he made what was unclear clear. And... so, yeah, from then on, I've never wanted another... I only went to that Tibetan teacher once, and then I realised, actually... I must have realised Bhante was then my teacher, I was his disciple. Mm.
So you did have an inner experience of being a disciple.
I did. I've always thought of myself as a disciple. I feel honoured to be a disciple of Sangharakshita, actually. I know some people have a problem with the word. But I love it, you know. Mm. I mean, I don't feel like... He's never really ever told me what to do. Mm. I mean, sometimes he's told me what not to do. Or
have
hinted
you done that?
Very strongly, no.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes I have. And, it seemed something very natural, really, just to be with him and do things with him. Quite normal. But when he gave talks... It was like a different person, and I guess this was the same throughout my all the many years I was in a community with him or met up with him. it always felt the same, that it was just like a very ordinary, well, you can't say Banti was ordinary, he was unusual, but he was just a human being, and he had a particular taste, so they weren't always my taste and so on. But when he gave talks or led meditations, something else happened. I like to think it was a transmission of some sort that took place, and it certainly felt like that. And he showed me how to discover my own rich inner spiritual life, really, and very, very grateful to him. And I feel very, very grateful to him now, after all these years. And very honoured to be one of his disciples.
Thank you. I wonder if your relationship went through quite a lot of different phases, because that's a lot of years, and both of you aged during that process, and there was ill health that happened, particularly for him, as well as different kind of geographical places. So were there very different phases in your life there?
Well, there were very different phases in my life, because
true.
I think my friendship with Banti and my relationship with him was pretty much the same. You know, I was a bit like, if I said I was a servant to him, that might give you the wrong impression, but I like to serve him. I like to help him with things. And, if I was with him at an event, I used to sort of make sure he had a cup of tea and you know, people weren't crowding around too much and things like that. Sometimes he used to ask me to leave him alone because he was quite happy. So it was a bit like... it's a bit like looking after your dad, really, sort of making sure he's, well, probably people wouldn't do that for their dads, but, you know, just kind of looking after him. And when I first went to live at Padmaloka, he asked me to be the chair, because the first chair, it didn't work out after a couple of months, and we were walking in the garden. I said, oh, it's a bit of a problem, isn't it? And he said, yeah. I said, you probably need a new chair. And he said, yeah, we will. And I said, well, do you want me to do it? And he said, oh, that would be a good idea. I think that's what happened. And when I became, I'm telling you that, is when I became the chair, I felt very, very inexperienced. I was 28, I think. And I was living in this men's community, one of the first men's communities. It was very unpleasant sometimes. There were lots of conflicts and we were all trying to work out what it meant to live together. And so I used to meet up with Banti every morning, and this was before he had a secretary or anything. So we used to just talk about the community and what Padmaloka was there for and things. And he used to often talk about personal things. He'd tell me about his mother and sister and that he was thinking of visiting them and so on. So it was kind of very informal, friendly kind of relationship. I just would like to add, actually, one of the things that Banti did for me, I came from a very sort of uncultured background, really. I trained to be an engineer, and I didn't really read books and things like that, but Banti gave me a kind of cultural education. Mm-hmm. He used to lend me books, novels mainly, to read. And I think first I worked my way all the way through the D.H. Lawrence novels, first of all, which is quite an effort sometimes. But and I'd take the one book back and say, what would you recommend next? And he'd give me another one. And it kind of went on like this. And, you know, I worked my way through quite a lot of English classics. And I probably just didn't know very much about music. And I thought some of the order members did, you know. I mean, one order member took me to an opera and he said it's a really serious opera. It's called Orpheus in the Underworld. And it was by Offenbach, is it? It's actually a comedy opera buffa. And it's quite funny. So I realised actually order members didn't always know what they were talking about. So I think I just followed Banti's taste, really, and started listening to baroque music and so on. So it was not only a spiritual journey for me, but a kind of an opening up of a whole treasure chest of wonderful things to read.
Yeah.
And he seemed to always encourage me to read novels. In fact, he sometimes thought people ought to read more novels because, yeah. You know, he didn't know why they read so much Buddhist books, really. It's all pretty simple, Buddhism, really. Tells you get the sort of principles, and then he said in novels you see see karma acting itself out time and time again, if you can put it like that.
And there was this time much later in your life with Bante where you just moved to Majibloko to help him when he wasn't sleeping and he was very unhappy.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember it going out in the movement, we kind of knew, oh, Sona has gone down to help Bante to serve him.
No, well, that's not...
That wasn't true.
No. Yeah.
I was actually living at Majibloko.
Okay.
So I moved to Majibloko for the second time.
Yeah.
And sort of rather ironically, in the end of 2002, this must have been, I went on a solitary retreat in December. Mm. That would be at the end of 2002. I went on a solitary retreat, and I had a kind of experience on this solitary retreat that it was a bit like my mind was just full of thoughts, and the spiritual life was just full of thoughts. You know, I had this kind of moment where I just felt it's no point in living the spiritual life because it's just an idea. Mm. And it was a bit like I didn't know what to do. I won't tell you exactly what happened on the retreat, take too long on the retreat, but I came to the conclusion that the most important thing in life would be to just care for people. Mm. That you couldn't really guarantee anything you were learning about spiritual life. It was all kind of ideas. And I just thought, it's thoughts, it's just more thoughts, and it's thoughts about thoughts about thoughts about thoughts. Mm. And I kind of just suddenly thought, I can't go any further with this. And and I was in a relationship with Vidyamala at the time, and I thought, I know, I'd like to go and look after her. But when I got back from that solitary retreat, I discovered that Bante wasn't sleeping very well. And quite quickly, I was one of the people he asked to spend the night looking after him. When he couldn't sleep at night, he liked to have someone around he could talk to. Mm. So, I can't say I was happy to do it, but I was happy to, in a way I was happy to do it. It was like a duty. But he used to wake me up several times in the middle of the night. Mm. And again, it was very moving, although it was difficult because I didn't get enough sleep, but it was very moving sitting with him. Mm. Sometimes I'd just sit and ask to hold my hand, like he asked, you mentioned that film. And he would tell me about his dreams, and he felt kind of anxious, really, because he knew he just wasn't getting enough sleep, and it was quite painful. Mm. It was very painful seeing him in that state.
And you were also seeing him in probably in a state of mind that you weren't used to seeing him in. I mean, how did you navigate that? You know, you're saying like sometimes he was just an old man, and sometimes he was this great teacher. Now you're seeing him as something else.
I think what I did think quite a lot about that. Mm. That he seemed quite anxious, and sometimes unreasonably so. Like he sometimes wanted to have a car available to take him to hospital, and then he'd want to have another car available in case the first car broke down. So he was in a quite a strange state at that time, and I was trying to work out, how do you sort of reconcile that with someone who's been practicing, meditating the Dharma their whole life? And I came to the conclusion that certain things happen to you when you're ill. Chemicals change in your body, and as we all know, if you drink alcohol, you feel a bit weird. If you're anaesthetized, you go unconscious, and so on. And I kind of worked out that there must have been something going on in the chemistry of his body that was just outside of the control of the conscious mind. Mm. And it was very, very helpful reflecting on all that, actually. It was a bit of a teaching in a way, is that if you're trying to gain enlightenment just to avoid suffering, that won't work, because whilst you've got a physical body, you're always going to have pain and difficulties, but how you dealt with it. And I've never met anyone before who couldn't sleep, and so I had no idea how you dealt with that. Mm. And but he just did the best he could, really. Mm. I mean, it was really, really chronic, and really sometimes it would go days without any sleep at all.
Yeah.
It's really difficult.
Yeah, thank you. Did did Bhante ever give you any feedback? When we rehearsed this, he said, no.
No. I don't remember him giving me... Well, he gave me some positive feedback once. He walloped me on the shoulder. I was sitting at the dinner table, and he got up and walked past, and he went, wallop, and went forward. And he said, I just like doing that because you're so solid. And he said, come up to my room, I want to give you something. So I went up there, and he gave me this little black Buddha. He said, I want to give you this Buddha. I thought of you when I was looking at it because it's black and it's solid. I didn't know what the black meant, but I had no idea what the solid meant. So he gave me this lovely Buddha. But when I lived in Sweden, I don't think Bhante was particularly interested in me going setting up the centre in Sweden, because I was the chair at Padmaloka, and well, one of the things I knew about him, because people told me this, that he found me very, very reliable, and I was good at taking responsibilities. I'm quite good in a crisis. I'm pretty useless at planning things, but in a crisis I don't panic and things. I have ideas what to do and so on. So he really felt he could rely on me. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to have a bit of an adventure and things. Mm-hmm. I was only in my late 20s, so I wanted to go and set up a centre. And so I went off to Stockholm. But when I was there, everything went quite well to start with. I had a men's community after 6 months and 6 mitras, and then an order member. There was an order member there after 2 years, so I was doing quite well. Mm-hmm. And then it was a very, very difficult time for me. And I kept suggesting that maybe I should move back to England. And so I'd write these letters. This was before the internet. Mm. I'd write letters to Bhante. And I had a very close friendship with Subhuti. And so I'd write to Subhuti. And Subhuti says, yeah, I think you really need to get back to England. It's just not doing you any good in Sweden. And then Subhuti, I remember on one occasion, Subhuti said this in a letter, or he said it verbally to me when I was in England. And then very shortly afterwards, he said, no, it's really important that you stay there. And I go, but you said recently, he said, yeah, but I've been talking to Bhante. And I worked out this is what Bhante had said. Mm. And then he did, I think he then did admit, he said, Sona needs to learn something. Mm-hmm. He needs to stay there. That was maybe they're not the quite right words, but he gave me some feedback indirectly, mm-hmm. that I had to learn something. I couldn't have my cake and eat it, I think was what I was told. You'll have to work that one out for yourself.
We're trying to work out what the cake was.
Well, some of my friends would tell
me. Yeah, all right then, let's not go there. Is there anything about your relationship with Bhante or a lecture or a book or something that you still use as a reference point? I mean, maybe it's just your friendship with him and your connection with him that's still very alive for you.
Well, the answer is yes and no, in a way. There's when I worked in, not worked, but lived at Padmaloka working with the ordination team, I would constantly be going through the Bhante's books and a survey of Buddhism, the Three Jewels at the Guhyaloka retreat, the ordination retreat, and so on. And recently, I've just rediscovered the essence of Zen, because Saddhanandi invited me to lead a retreat here with her, so I thought I'd better reread. I listened to the lectures actually, and it was really lovely listening to Bhante give those lectures, which were in 1965. And I think what I love about Bhante is that he can make something very simple, and I think that it's very much about transmission what he's got in that book, and I think in a way I've had a lot of transmission from him, without it ever being like Banti's here going to transmit to me. It's just sort of happened, even at like dinner time. You know, he might be talking about Christianity, which was sometimes his favourite subject, or politics, or all sorts of things. Mm. And he would, sometimes there was just some things transmitted which would broaden your mind. And I think he taught me how to think as well, that to question things, not just take things as a given. So sometimes some people find me a bit awkward, because when they say something, I always say the opposite, you know. just so that you could argue the point and get some information. And so things like that.
You learned that from him a bit.
I think so, yeah. He thought people should learn to think clearly.
Yeah.
And so I did my best to. Yeah. I'm not sure I'm a great clear thinker, but I learned to be awkward.
Which you might have got from him.
He was quite fun sometimes. Banti was great at repartee. Mm. In the early days of the men's community, he used to, every evening mealtime, at lunchtime he was very quiet because he was usually writing and we weren't allowed to sort of make much noise, but in the evenings he used to sort of start a little discussion. Mm. And it'd say very, very provocative things. Mm. And very much against the kind of currents of, you know, politics or things. And and he'd always have the last word. Mm. About what he said. So he used to quite enjoy that repartee. He'd say, what do you think of that? And you'd say what you thought, and you'd say, well, yeah, but what about this and what about that? Mm. And so yeah, he was a lot of fun actually to live with. Mm. And as I say, just broad. If you hadn't sort of read the Bible or knew Greek myths, he would definitely broaden out things for you. English literature. A lot of the time, I had no idea what he was talking about, but it was just nice sometimes sitting at mealtimes listening to him.
And were there aspects of Banti? Well, you were very much in contact with Banti as a human being, as a man, yeah? What, did he appear in your inner life?
Oh, I had dreams about him, yeah. I can't remember many of them, but yeah. I did have quite a few. Yeah. I do remember one where I had a decision to make, quite a big decision. And I remember running like one of these magical Tibetan figures that could run very fast from Norfolk down to Cornwall, and where he was on solitary retreat. And I asked him, I said, can I ask you a question, Banti? And he was a bit irritated with me in the dream. I can't remember what the question was, but it was a big question. And he just said, it was a bit like, he said, well, what do you think you ought to do? And I told him, he said, well, go and do it. He appeared in my dreams.
Did that dream teach you anything or say anything?
It may have done. Yeah, I can't really remember. I think it's certainly been in my meditations a lot. Yeah. And I suppose there's sort of Banti. It's not really Banti 1 and Banti 2, because that was his classification. Mm. But there is a kind of Banti that is the one you see, which was always a bit odd for me, because you're in a community, he'd be in his scruffy jumper, sometimes unshaven, shuffling around with his slippers and things. And he wasn't exactly like the archetypal guru figure swanning around in robes. He was kind of just like, you know, an ordinary old man. Mm. And but then there was this other side. Mm. So I think that other side, you know, kind of felt very close to, actually. Mm. Felt close to both in a way, but I've probably felt less close to the physical Banti, because I didn't really have all that much I could talk to him about.
Yeah.
You know, I came from an engineering background.
Yeah.
I once tried to ask him a Buddhist question. I thought, you know, I'll go and see him. You know, people often do this. You think, I'd like to see Banti, and then you think you have to have a question. So I tried to come up with a question. And I remember going to see him in Bethnal Green in his flat. And I said, can I ask you something about meditation, Banti? He said, okay. And I asked him, and he said, why are you asking me that question? just go and read about it in my books. I've said enough about it. Yeah. That was probably a bit of feedback.
Yeah. Be your own person.
So I quickly changed the subject and asked him if he's heard anything from his mum recently.
So on a slightly similar track, did your relationship or your friendship with Bhante require effort? You know, did you have to sort of step up to it when you went to see him?
No, it's all quite natural. I used to feel, I probably felt a little bit, actually living with Bhante, he wouldn't make you, but you very often would feel, that's trouble when you get old, you keep forgetting words.
Give me a clue.
Inadequate, that was the word. And, you know, he knew so much and he thought about so many diverse things. Last time I saw him, he told me he was reading quantum mechanics or quantum gravity. And so I went and bought the book to find out why I was reading it. And it was always surprising you and things. But so sometimes just you would, to know where you were, you often compare, well, I think you compare yourselves to other people. Mm. If you compare yourself to him, it was not very...
Flattering,
no. I was probably more practical than him, so I kind of feel, you know, I had one up there. But
I remember when he was reading, or he was listening to those books on audio.
Oh, yeah.
And it was in the last year or so before he died. And I was saying to him, do you understand it, Bhante? And he's saying, not really, Saddhanandi, but it is amazing. I mean, he said, it does change your mind in terms of what the universe is. And then he said, I'm going to listen to it all over again, see if I can get hold of it a bit more. You know, he was actually really was
you
trying
to... You didn't ask him what he thought was amazing about it?
I think it was just that he felt his mind was being expanded again.
Yeah.
By just the, how it, the perspective that that...
Well, it was called that reality isn't what it seems.
Yes. So I think he was being expanded. Yeah. I'm just thinking about what Vidya Devi said on that that film, that he was somebody who liked to learn. He was always learning, and he was still learning about that. So how important for you was it that you had a relationship with a real teacher or somebody you saw of as a teacher, as a disciple, for instance?
I'm not sure I've ever thought of
like that.
That kind of question.
No.
It's just like... Bhante turned up in my life when I was 23.
Yeah.
Got to know him.
Yeah.
He ordained me. He taught me to meditate. He taught me how to read English.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't even pronounce half the words in a book on Mahayana Buddhism on the first seminar I went to. He had to help me with my English. I couldn't even, and that's my mother tongue. And it just was always very encouraging. He sometimes used to get me to do things. He used to get me to go and talk to people. And, you know, when I was in the ordination team, sometimes there was times when I felt, what was the point? You know, particularly when you're preparing people for ordination and they kind of do quite well for a while and then they seem to go off into orbit somewhere. It kind of makes you feel, is it worth it? And he was always very encouraging and told me it was and things like that. So everything really seemed quite natural. And, you know, I like to think of myself as a quite simple bloke. Mm. You know? And so I don't sort of think of him. I never understood why people were so interested to know whether he was enlightened or not. I could understand it in a way, but it wasn't one of the questions I ever asked. I just thought, here was this person that completely radically changed my life, and I'm so grateful for that. I just, you know, not sure I'd have lived that long even with the sort of life I had, and it would have, you know, wouldn't have been a life worth living, I think.
Yeah.
But I've had a really good life as an order member and taking on responsibility and doing things and just getting encouragement to do that. And I said I was so grateful before, but it was just like he was there in my life. And he sometimes used to send messages, usually via Subhuti.
Yeah.
He said, I haven't seen Sona for a long time. You know, what's happened to him? Tell him I'd like to see him.
Yeah.
And so I was a bit lax, really, when he moved here. But it was awkward with Banti in the last few years because he was so tired a lot of the time. And, you know, I'd like to see him just to... I was going to say to pay my respects, but it was more than that, really. Mm. Just as a friend and just go and see him. Mm. And very often I was surprised, actually, I'd end up spending an hour with him or something. And, you know,
Very easy.
A matter of fact kind of friendship, really.
Yeah. And I've often thought your faith in him and faith in the order didn't seem to falter.
Never.
I mean, what where were you drawing on that? What were you standing on to kind of maintain that quality of faith?
I suppose my own inner experiences, really.
Yeah.
And which, you know, I would never have had if I hadn't met Banti.
Yeah.
Probably meditation and my, I mean, I still do the same sadhana practice that he gave me 45 years ago.
Yeah. So
I do it, you know, I do that and one other, but I've been doing it 45 years, since I'm posting here, but for the first 20 something years every day and then every other day, the Waktara practice.
Wow.
And... yeah, I've been part of a really big project, the founding of the order, the Buddhist movement. I suppose in a way I really wanted to be an order member because I wanted to change the world.
Yeah.
And I thought the only way you're going to change the world is to change people. And you couldn't do it on your own. So I just met this group of people that were all really keen on hammering out a whole different way of living in communities and working together and so forth. And I did all those things and I benefited enormously from them all.
Yeah.
I still got a lot of faith and confidence. Even though I don't live in a community now, I mean, definitely would recommend everyone had experience of that. So.
Thank you. I've just got a couple more questions.
Trying to think of an awkward question to ask you. When did you first meet Banti?
I mostly met him through his seminars, reading seminars and listening to his lectures a lot. That would have been in 83, 84 onwards. He did come to the women's community in Glasgow, where I was living. He was visiting Glasgow, and he came round and I'd cooked him the dinner.
Yeah.
I cooked him lasagna, I remember, and I was saying to other people, and I cooked profiteroles, homemade profiteroles, and proper homemade profiteroles, you pour the hot chocolate sauce on top of them, you don't have these little blobs of chocolate on the top, he came round and we gave him the lasagna and then I gave him the chocolate, the profiteroles, and I said, and here's the chocolate sauce. He said, no, I won't have the chocolate sauce. And I said, no, but you must have the chocolate sauce because it doesn't taste of anything. He said, no, I won't have it. I said, no, Banti. He said, all right, I'll just have the chocolate sauce. Suppose if you ask a Buddha three times, you know. I think he thought, I'm onto a loser here, you know.
As far as I remember, he wasn't a great cook. He did cook me a few meals in the early days when he lived at Castle Acre. And he did a good dal, and he told me the secret of a good dal was lots of salt.
Yeah, later.
But they were very tasty. Yeah.
Well, I think later on I discovered he was probably on a diet at that time, poor thing. So he's getting profiteroles forced down him by a Glaswegian mitra. From your experience, who was Banti?
Well, I suppose I could answer that anyway, couldn't I? I suppose for me, in my mind, I guess, and it's something he said, or he's written about, where he often, well, he doesn't often, but I like to think he was like a medium through which something was passing.
Mm.
Like he mentioned somewhere, it was as though there was a voice or another power or something speaking through him. And I suppose that's my view of him, really. Mm. He was a human being. He was very knowledgeable and intellectual and et cetera, et cetera. But he was also a kind of conduit or a portal through which something far greater than anything we normally experience can flow through.
Mm.
And I guess that's kind of what a transmission is, really. It's like where a human being, sometimes called a teacher, but in a way it's not really teaching you anything. It's like just opening up something for you. And that's how I see him, and that's my memory of him, and that's what I'm grateful for.
Mm.
And if there's any, you know, any little faults that he's had, in comparison to this almost like cosmic activity, all the other things are just so minor.
Mm.
And I don't, you know, I don't think very much about him as him as a human being and his faults. I just think we've all got faults and we're all working with them, and sometimes we do things and we're not pleased about what we've done later on.
Mm.
But there was something on a completely different level that was happening as well.
Yeah.
And I'm totally convinced of that.
Yeah.
And I think that's where my faith comes from. And I wouldn't say it's even faith, because it's kind of, it's confidence.
Yeah.
And I've experienced it and it's changed me.
Yeah.
And I like to think that sometimes it happens when I've ordained people. Or,
yeah.
And when I'm, I've never thought of myself as a teacher, and I've always thought of Banti. In fact, the most beautiful image I have from Banti is the finger pointing to the moon.
Mm.
And I guess I never looked at the finger too much.
Mm.
And I looked at tried to look at the moon. And Banti was the finger.
Mm.
And so he got me looking beyond him to something wonderful.
Mm.
And both spiritually and beauty and truth, all these things. Yeah.
And my sense with all friendships, with all relationships or friendships, the different aspects of us come out in that relationship, that friendship. So who are you in relationship to Banti?
I think I'm the trusted servant.
The trusted servant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The reliable servant. A brick.
And what does it feel like to have... to be trusted by the consciousness that you've just described?
Well, for me, it feels quite normal for some reason.
Mm.
I don't, you know, it's just, you probably experienced this, you know, taking a lot of responsibility for other people, and you have to be there.
Yeah.
You can't fall over when things go wrong. You've got to be strong. Mm. And that's what people trust you, and then you kind of trust yourself. Even though if you start thinking about it, you kind of might have a wobbly or something like that. But actually, you know you can be strong and do what's needed.
Mm.
So I think, what was the question again? Did that answer it?
You're the trusted servant.
Yeah.
But he trusted you?
I always felt he trusted me, and he liked having me around.
Yeah.
Maybe not always in the room talking to him, but...
Yeah.
You know, nearby.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think actually, I like to think anyway, and I suspect he did, that when I was around, he relaxed a bit more.
Yeah.
Certainly when I had sort of, you know, like a Padmaloka and Marjimaloka, I think I sometimes felt that a bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, then, just one more question. It's obvious, really. Is there anything else you want to add to this conversation?
I think I think several people have said this about Banti and, you know, him not being with us anymore.
Mm.
That I think Sona Locust said this in one of our chapter meetings. That in some ways, when Banti was no longer in the annex, it was as though he was available to everyone somehow.
Mm.
Did you say that? It was something like that. It's a bit like, because he's no longer physically there, you have to have a different relationship with him. You can't go on thinking, I mean, I sometimes go up to the burial mound and then I just imagine all the Banti turning into bones and a skeleton. Right? I'm not familiar with how long it takes. in the earth, but I kind of think it's probably not a pretty sight. Mm. So it's not exactly something I go and I know some people like the, looking at death in that way. I just don't find it very aesthetic. But I like to feel that he's all around me, it's almost like he's speaking to me, and so on. Mm. So, yeah, I just feel. I feel his presence here. You can say that, and you may be not quite sure what it means, but certainly it is a joy coming here.
Yeah.
And there is something special about where he's buried and what we're doing today and everything.
Yeah.
You know, just this is Banti's place and home. And I was a trustee of the charity that helped set it up, so I kind of feel connected as well. Mm. So my whole life has been connected to Banti, really.
Yeah, it has.
Very strongly, yeah.
And if Banti was alive and you and I went to visit him after this interview, what do you think he'd be saying?
He'd probably ask me, did you tell him about this or did you tell him about that? Or something.
Yeah. And then we'd say, probably not. He'd always be disappointed.
I don't know if he would, actually. Yeah. I don't think he'd even ask, actually.
No.
No,
he would. He would ask
would
me.
He'd ask you. He wouldn't ask me.
Yeah.
He might be a bit surprised I was doing an interview, actually.
No. Yeah, no.
Well, he used to tell me to... I don't know if I should tell you this, but he used to tell me to go off, and he used to say, "And make sure you sock it to them." Like sometimes I think he thought that people were getting a bit kind of stuck in their views, and it was good to have someone who stirred the pot a little bit. And I think that's what he used to. I think that's why I learned to be a bit provocative, because I was just a good, faithful servant.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I probably got a natural inclination to do it, and he saw it in me. So, yeah. And I know what he would say. So, well, how many people were there?
Oh.
And you know, was so and so there? And he would. That's what he always did with me. Gathered information. It was a bit like I was a spy, because I used to travel to a lot of centres.
Yeah.
And when I come back, he would say, "So, what's happening in Sydney, and what happened in." Somewhere else, and I'd tell him, and I know that other people told him as well. So he would he wouldn't tell me what other people told him.
Yeah.
So he was just gathering all this information, like modern spies do, you know, just information, and he like knew what was happening.
He certainly did know what was happening.
He certainly did. God, yeah.
I remember being I was chair at Taraloka, and I once got a phone call from somebody from Parami, just as she said in that film, and. Banti had asked her to contact me and ask me a question about something he'd just heard. And something had happened at Taraloka maybe 4 or 5 days before, and he already knew about it.
Yeah.
You wouldn't imagine it, that he could have such a good network of information.
Yeah.
But he was also very, very, He cared about every single centre. Yeah. He really cared. Yeah.
Just one last one. You were talking. I think one of the last things he ever asked me to do a few years ago.
Yeah.
Quite a few years ago now. He rang me up and he said to me he would like me to talk to a certain Ord member, who was having difficulties with Banti and kind of not speaking very well about him. And he asked me to talk to this person.
Mm.
And basically what he said, I was saying, yeah, it's a shame that, he doesn't appreciate you more or something. And he said, well, the thing is, I want him to know that, how did he put it? He said, he doesn't really know what he's been given. And that's what he was concerned about. He wasn't concerned about what he thought of Banti and so on. Mm. He was concerned that this order member was not really reconciling the fact that he'd been given something so precious that he was about to lose it if he wasn't careful.
Mm.
And that's what he was... He wanted me to convey that to him.
Mm.
I found it really moving, actually, that he was... I don't think... he didn't like people... criticising him, but he was just very, very concerned about that individual.
And their connection with the Dharma.
Yeah, and they're still involved in the order, and you know, they've been in a bit of a loop, a bit of an orbit, but they've come back, and you know, finding satisfaction and help, you know, all the good things being in the order gives you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. And thank you to Sona for talking a little bit about his friendship with Bhante. Yeah.
Pleasure.
Yeah. I mean, everyone's got a slightly different relationship with him, and
but
yours is great to hear. And I know how fond and how trusting he was of you. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that made a big, that would have made a particular difference to him at different times in his life.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
overall, it made a difference to him knowing you were there. Yeah. Great.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
For interviewing me.
Thank you.